today's speaker, Professor Donald Brown. And first, I'd like to thank Mary and Peter House, who unfortunately are not here today. Mary was supposed to make her debut back at our Sunday morning program, but she just wasn't feeling well enough this morning. So they're here anyway with us today. And I want to thank them for helping us get this fine speaker this morning, the colleagues and dear friends of Linda and Don House. Donald Brown is a scholar in residence for sustainability, ethics, and law at Widener's Environmental Law Center. He previously worked at Penn State University, where he taught interdisciplinary courses on climate change and sustainable development. He also directed the Pennsylvania Environmental Research Consortium, an organization of 56 Pennsylvania universities and the Pennsylvania Departments of Environmental Protection and Conservation and Natural Resources. He previously worked as a program manager for the United Nations organizations at the U.S. EPA's Office of International Environmental Policy. He represented the agency on U.S. delegations to the United Nations negotiating climate change, biodiversity, and sustainable development issues. Please welcome this morning's speaker, Donald Brown.
I bow to you for two reasons. The first reason, I just came back from teaching in Japan, and both the teachers and the students started the class by bowing and ending. It's a wonderful, wonderful, I really like it a lot. The other reason why I bow to you is my heart is with the Ethical and Cultural Society. I completely support this. I understand your mission. I'm currently in the humanist wing of the Unitarian Church in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, only because we don't have an Ethical and Cultural Society. So I'm really delighted to be here. What am I going to talk about? I guess we should have trouble with the computer.
All right.
Well, I will continue, and maybe we'll catch up with the slides, okay? What I'm here for is for you to help me, okay? Climate change is an extraordinarily ethically and morally challenging public policy question. But we don't talk about it that way. We talk about it in terms of cost-benefit analysis and economic interests or scientific uncertainty. The debate in the United States and in most countries of the world is ignoring when we talk about climate change, that it is an ethical problem. The other element of this that I'm going to try to convince you of is because it's an ethical problem, it has enormous significance for policy. You can't think clearly about the policy issues without seeing the ethical issues, so I'm going to try to explain that to you. The failure to see the ethical issue means that you can't think clearly about what you need to think about, okay? The third thing I'm going to try to convince you of is the United States has been a horrible, horrible global citizen on this issue. And the last thing is I'm here to have you help me to try to figure out how to turn up in the United States the ethical and moral dimensions of it, to get the press to finally cover it, the ethical and moral dimensions, to change the way that we debate it. So that's what I'm up to. Okay, now there's something about this problem in particular that raises very squarely moral and ethical questions, in fact, in ways that other environmental issues do not. Now, I find as I travel around the country, people don't know why you talk about ethics and morals. What is this thing called ethics and morals? The level of knowledge about why you would want to frame something as an ethical question is disturbingly low. Even in graduate students in universities, they don't spot the obvious ethical questions. They were often been trained to think of everything as self-interest, as economic cost-benefit analysis. So when we talk about policy, we usually talk about self-interest. A moral issue is an issue that raises not simply interests, but obligations, duties, and responsibilities. It's about what's right or wrong. Okay, if you talk about self-interest, you hide all of the ethical and moral questions, okay? So there's something about this problem in particular that makes it obviously an ethical issue. The first thing about this problem is that it's a problem caused by some people in the world that are hurting and putting other people in the world who have usually done nothing much to cause the problem at great risk. So there's an amazing distribution between the people causing the problem, the people that are the risk. So that's one reason why it's uniquely a moral problem. Another reason is that the harms to the victims are not mere inconveniences, they're catastrophic in many cases. So you're talking about some group of people, usually rich people in developed countries, that are not in the future, but are right now creating great misery already. I'm a contributing author to the Intergovernment Panel on Climate Change. Just one second here. Next slide. Okay, so, and there are environmental harms already we can see around the world, and there are places which are being impacted by climate change right now. So it's not a future problem, it's a current problem, and we've already baked 1 degree centigrade into what we've done. So the minimum temperature change we now think we're going to see is 2 degrees centigrade. A little more about that number. Next slide. So here you see a slide of the countries which are the highest emitters on the top, and the countries which are the most vulnerable countries are at the bottom in red. Next slide. As I said, the second reason why it's an ethical question is we're not talking about inconveniences, we're talking about catastrophic harms. Next slide. We know that climate change is already creating enormous flooding. Next slide. Killer heat waves. Next slide. Food supply losses. There are parts of the world where this is not simply an inconvenience, but it's an existential threat to their very existence. The small island developing states in the United Nations have been screaming for 30 years. I've been in the middle of this for 30 years. Stop this. This is a death sentence for us. On this slide, there are several island nations, Vanuatu, Kiribati, Tuvalu, whose very existence is threatened by this problem. Next slide. It's causing killer droughts, particularly in Africa, more about that. Next slide. There are some, Southeast Asia is extraordinarily vulnerable to this. The Brahmaputra and the Ganges River are glacier fed. There are hundreds of millions of people that depend upon the glaciers feed for both agriculture and drinking water supplies. They're starting to dry up. There's already water scarcity problems that we're seeing in them, and it's caused because the glaciers are melting. Next slide. Africa is a basket case for this problem. On the left-hand side of that slide, you see where droughts are expected to be more frequent. On the right-hand side of that slide are droughts which are expected to be more killer droughts. Next slide. The third thing about this problem that makes it, that it screams for attention to be understood as a moral and ethical problem, is that the victims can't do anything to protect themselves. They can't petition their governments. Their only hope is that the developed countries will see that they not only have interests, but duties and responsibilities, and will change their behavior. So, there are unique aspects of this problem that screams for attention for it to be understood to be an ethical problem. Next slide. The next thing I want to draw your attention to is, but you really, the really importance is seeing not just that it's a moral problem, but the ethical issues raised by policy questions about this problem. I'm going to go through them. The first, next slide. This slide will require a little bit of description. The first problem, the first practical problem, is no country can set a target, a greenhouse gas emissions target, without implicitly taking a position on two profound civilization-challenging ethical issues. Any national target, Obama's target, is implicitly a position on two sub-issues embedded in that target which raise profound ethical issues. The first issue is that any target is implicitly a position on the atmospheric stabilization level. How high in the atmosphere are we going to let carbon dioxide rise to? Every target is already a position on that. That's a profound ethical question, because if the United States takes a position on that, in that one step, it's deciding how much harm it's willing to enact upon the Africans and the people in Southeast Asia. So that alone makes it an ethical question, but the press isn't covering it that way. And even, in fact, the environmental NGOs are not covering it that way. Well, I'll explain that in a second. To understand this slide, this is important. On the left-hand side, you see numbers. And then you have five columns representing different kind of environmental impacts. The darker the red, the higher the probability you start to have really serious impacts. If you notice, at about 2 degrees centigrade, all the charts get red, okay? So there are five different kinds of impacts that the mainstream scientific institutions, including the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, the U.S. Academy of Sciences, the Royal Academy of Sciences, the American Association for the Advancement of Science, just in the last 2 months said, whoa, we're headed for really bad stuff if we don't reverse this, okay? The magic thing about this chart is that at 2 degrees centigrade, the probabilities start to increase that a number of things happen. Next slide. In the climate system, if we continue to warm the planet, the temperatures are not going to increase like if you turned up a dial, okay? Where you turn up the light, the light increases in proportion to where the dial is. It's a smooth linear function. The climate system has non-linear switches in the system, not only dials. So, and we know a lot of them. They're representatives. There's methane stored in the permafrost in Russia. There's methane hydrates off the Atlantic coast. There's a real possibility that we collapse the Arctic ice. If you collapse the Arctic ice, you don't get a smooth change. You get a rapid change in temperature, because all of a sudden the what's called the albedo, the reflection of the sun, goes away, and all of a sudden the Earth starts to absorb rather than reflect the radiation back into space. So all these things are called triggers in the climate system. So if you exceed certain temperatures, you have rapid nonlinear changes. Temperature just doesn't increase as a dial. It responds as if you threw a switch. Next slide. This is a slide from the United States Academy of Sciences about abrupt climate change. Up in the right-hand corner, you see a relatively stable temperature regime. That's the last 10,000 years. Humans are living on one of the most stable, unusual, abnormal, calm periods in Earth history than the Earth has ever seen. If you go back 100,000 years, you see these rapid, nonlinear responses to the climate system. And we know a lot of them, and they are because we've crossed one of these thresholds or triggers in the climate system. So the mainstream scientific community is really worried that we are going to trigger rapid changes in the future, and that's what a lot of the science is. Now, we don't know exactly where some of these triggers are. We think methane hydrates are starting to leak already. The methane hydrates in the oceans probably will be triggered in another 50 or 60 years. The Arctic breakup of the Arctic ice is unknown, so there's different level of science about how we know precisely where these triggers are. But we're clearly running the risk that we do this. Next slide. Okay, now we're starting to get to the policy stuff. So if you set a target, you're taking implicitly a position on the atmospheric concentration level, which will then cause different temperature regimes, okay? So if carbon dioxide is at 450 parts per million, you have an upper and lower bound about how much temperature change you're going to cause, and because you don't know exactly the temperature, all of this is talked about in upper and lower bounds rather than exactly what's going to happen. But here's something I want to bring to your attention. The red line there is the 450 part per million, what it would take the globe to stabilize at 450 part per million. But in the middle of that, is the probability of you, if you exceed the 2 degrees centigrade, because of uncertainty about climate sensitivity, there is a 45 to 86% chance that we're going to shoot past the 2 degrees centigrade. Let me repeat that. At 450 parts per million, there's a 45 to 86% chance that we shoot past the 2 degrees centigrade. Does anybody know what the current carbon dioxide level is in the world? Surely someone knows. What's the current? 400. Well, it's actually about 440, because if you take methane and the other greenhouse gases, we're already at 440 parts per million of carbon dioxide equivalent. So because of this, we are running out of time to keep the temperature at 2 degrees centigrade. We're literally, so if you know the atmospheric concentration, it's pretty straightforward mathematical calculation what the budget is for the rest of the world that will prevent the temperature from exceeding 450 parts per million. So it's a pretty straightforward calculation. So there are now temperature budgets. And the latest budget says the whole world, if we're going to stabilize at 450 parts per million, which gives you less than a 50% chance you're going to shoot by the 2 degrees centigrade, we have about 270 gigatons of carbon left, and we've got to distribute them through the entire world. The entire world has, the number is somewhat controversial, between 270 and 320 gigatons. And we're currently emitting at 10 gigatons, and it's going up, not going down. What that means is in 27 years, there's zero left for the world. There's no budget left. We exceeded the 260 parts per million. Next slide. This shows you the civilization challenging nature of the problem. The dark green line is the emissions reductions that the world must meet, the reductions to the year 2090 to have any hope of stabilizing at a 2 degrees centigrade limit. By the way, the whole world's already agreed in Copenhagen to try to limit the warming to 2 degrees. Everybody's agreed with that. But there's a controversy because there's a real question whether 2 degrees is not tough enough to prevent these nonlinear stuff. A lot of scientists think like 1.5 degrees. And the bottom line is what the emissions reductions that the world would need to stabilize to try to limit the warming to 1.5 degrees. Okay, we're now getting to understanding the ethical issues here. Okay, we're just getting there, okay. Next slide. Okay, the world is like a bathtub. The atmosphere is like a bathtub. It has a limited volume. Carbon dioxide is long-lived. That means it stays there actually for thousands of years. The half-life of carbon dioxide 120 years, that means, you know, thousands of years we'll still have some of the carbon dioxide. And the bathtub has been filling up. And now, let the lower line represent where we are, and the upper line might be where we would have to get to limit the warming to 2 degrees centigrade. We're running out of time. The bathtub is already filled up. But it hasn't been filled up by everybody. Okay, it's been filled up by rich developed countries. Okay, in the negotiations, I have been going to negotiations since they started. I was the Pennsylvania representative to the Earth Summit in 1992. And the whole world's developing countries have been saying, stop this, okay? We haven't stopped it. In the meantime, we're merely going on our way. Next slide. So, the ethical question, there are several about the atmospheric concentration level. In the negotiations, the issue today, in the negotiations, are the justice questions. At the international level, everybody is talking about them. But no one in the United States is talking about them. The press or New York Times is not covering it. I'm here to help you find people that will talk about this issue. We need to educate people about the justice dimensions of this issue. You know, this is per capita emissions. Everybody hears about China. The United States is still on the right-hand side is per capita. The only country that is currently above us in per capita emissions is Australia. Okay, so we're still much higher on a per capita basis than China. It is in fact true that China has more tons, but the ethics required, distributive justice requires you to think about responsibility, which would require you to think about per capita allocations. If we freeze the world of per capita emissions, if the developed countries are expected to simply reduce emissions to the same level we are, the per capita, we freeze them into a really low per capita level. So if we try to freeze our per capita emissions, then the developing countries get screwed by such a formula, and they know it, okay? So the issue becomes, what is the US fair share? Next slide. The other part of this that developing countries know much better than most Americans, that the United States is also responsible for historical emissions. We've put most of the water in the bathtub, okay? You can see the United States is down there in blue. China is relatively smaller than the United States. So the figuring out what your target should be is an ethical and moral problem, and any theory of ethics or distributive justice would make prior behavior partially responsible. And by the way, the closer we get to the limit, the less room there is for developing countries. And they know it. They know that they're running out of space. Next slide. This is hard to read, but let me just show you what it's trying to represent. This is the reductions on a state-by-state basis that would be expected if states reduced their emissions to equal per capita shares, given the 260 gigaton budget. You're talking about a civilization-challenging threat, and no one knows this, okay, in my views. The environmental NGOs are doing a bad job in talking about this, and I'll explain why that is taking place in just a second. The ethics of judgment. Now, even if we were to do this, developing countries would say that's not enough for the United States because there's no historical emissions. This is just freezing at equal per capita emissions, okay? So, let's now go to how it's been debated, all that's debated. And now I'm getting to the part where I hope I can convince you why seeing the ethical dimensions of this issue are so crucial. And the reason why the ethical dimensions are so crucial, not is it only an obviously question, but you can't talk coherently about the right-wing opposition to this problem unless you spot the ethical issues in their position. Next slide. Okay, so the first issue that you will hear, I've written two books about the history of the negotiations. I worked directly for the lead negotiator for the Reagan administration, a guy named Bill Nitze. I've been in the middle of this, and I try to explain to people to wake them up to the ethical dimensions of this issue, what the United States has been saying. So there's about seven arguments that the opponents of climate policy have continued to make for the last 30 years. One is in setting the target, we should simply base it on national interests. What can we afford to do? End of question. But that's obviously ethically wrong because it's a moral problem. It's obviously, no ethical system would allow a polluter who's killing other people to say, the polluter only has to reduce its emissions what they can afford, okay, without considering obligations, okay. The ethical problem with this is obvious. I like to say a monkey would get it, okay? Once you focus on the ethical issue. Next problem, next issue, okay? Another argument that has been made for the last 30 years, climate policies cost too much, okay? Every time you try to propose a climate policy, there's a huge, well-organized disinformation campaign funded by the fossil fuel industry and right-wing free market foundations that have been extremely well organized. I actually think, and this is a subject I'd like to talk about, this is some kind of new crime against humanity that they've been engaged to. Skepticism in science is a good thing. We want to encourage skepticism. But what they're doing is not skepticism. And I can say a lot more about precisely why they're doing it and why that's not skepticism. So they say we don't do this because it costs too much. Well, that's obviously ethically wrong because it's a moral problem. We don't just have economic interests. We have responsibilities and obligations to the people who's going to be harmed by that. Next slide. another claim you will hear now is going to become louder. We don't have to do anything because China didn't do anything, okay? That's another argument that the right will make. Well, that's ethics, that's not ethically, that doesn't wash. Okay, a polluter, if you have three polluters on the hill, and one of them says, I can continue killing people because the other two polluters are killing people, that's ludicrous. That wouldn't pass any ethical test. We're not asking the United States to do China's share, we're just asking the United States to do the United States' share of global emissions. And by the way, even if China does nothing, if the United States doesn't reduce its emissions, it is in fact causing harm because we're above our fair share and we're increasing atmospheric concentrations. So to do nothing because China does nothing still makes the problem worse. Next slide. Third argument is we don't have to do anything because of scientific uncertainty. There's no scientific basis. You're all familiar with this. There are actually a whole host of interesting ethical problems with this, not to mention just the U.S. Academy of Sciences issued 5 reports starting in the 1970s saying it's certain enough. You know, all the mainstream scientific institutions, every academy of science in the world, every scientific organization whose members have expertise in climate science, 97% of the scientists that do peer-reviewed science all support the consensus view. And the claims about the science are false. They're not reasonable skepticism. They're not making claims from peer-reviewed research. They're making it up. Skepticism is good, but we should expect the skeptics to play by the rules of science, which they are not in fact doing, which is in itself a moral failure. In fact, I think it's some sort of crime against humanity. There's other ethical problems with the scientific uncertainty argument. It seems to be based upon the rather dubious ethical claim that you don't do anything until you're sure about everything. But this is a problem if you wait till all the uncertainties involve, it's way too late, which is what seems to be the case. That the longer you wait, the harder it is to keep the warming to tolerable limits, which is a problem that we're starting to run up against because we've let the scientific uncertainty arguments color the U.S. citizens' description. The victims haven't consented to wait. The victims should have a role if you're going to use scientific uncertainty as an excuse for doing nothing. But yet the press isn't talking about it. Next slide. And there's a host of other policy issues. Next slide, sorry. So here's another amazing ethical problem that's already in play at very high level in the negotiations. Ethics would have those that cause problems, particularly when they're on notice, that they have responsibility for the damages, okay? The developing countries have been screaming. We agree there is a treaty that most Americans do not know that George Bush I actually signed, called the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, in which we agreed that developed countries should help pay adaptation for developing countries. So we all agreed to it. But ethics would require that those that cause problems, there's some interesting questions as when this is triggered, but those that cause problems have some responsibility. If you're worried about adverse economic impacts on the United States, the Americans better wake up to this problem, because if a court ever gets a hold of it, or if the developing countries force us to negotiate this, which I think is likely, we're going to have huge economic payments on our hands to developing countries. You know, the cost of Sandy was $60 billion alone. The cost of adaptation and damages may be extraordinarily high. The stupidity. This is a moment when only someone like John Stewart can tell the truth about the stupidity of the American people on this issue. We're storing treasures in hell if we get on the hook for adaptation and damages. And we've already agreed in principle, I'm an international environmental lawyer, there's a whole set of international environmental law principles that lead to the same result, that those that cause the problems have to pay part of the responsibility. Okay, and that's also ethically required. Next slide. Okay, now I'm going to end with a couple observations of where we are in the debate. These are the climate negotiations that started in 1988. 1988, the European Union walked into negotiations and said, this is a really serious problem. Every developed country should commit to binding legal targets, and we will commit, the European Union will commit to a 20% reduction below 1990 levels by the year 2000. The United States single-handedly prevented that from going forward, okay, from the world agreeing to a binding target. My boss was the negotiator, Bill Nitze. He wrote a book. That's a quote from his book. The United States single-handedly in 1988 prevented the world from adopting binding targets. So we've had the Kyoto Protocol. The United States is the only developed country in the world that didn't agree to the Kyoto Protocol. We have been resisting with some aid, from help from our friends occasionally Australia and Canada and a couple of other countries, so we always haven't been alone, but we have more frequent than not been the problem in the negotiations. As you probably know, Obama made a commitment to a 17% reduction below 2005, and he's trying to use the Clean Air Act to get there. But the story is, that's not enough. Okay, Obama's commitment is not near enough given the scale of the problem, okay? So we have been the problem. Next slide. So reviewing the debate in the United States, there have been six or seven arguments that the right wing, funded largely by free market fundamentalist foundations, fossil fuel companies, industry organizations like the Chamber of Commerce and the American Petroleum Institute have been funding, and it's been lies and distortions about the science, and the arguments that we've been using, there's not enough scientific support, it costs too much, we don't have to do anything until other countries do it. And in the debate, ethics does not come up. The justice debate, the ethics does not come up. And here, I'm critical of my environmental friends because they've been tricked into following the framing of the right. So the environmental groups, such as the Environmental Defense Fund, when the right says it costs too much, their response is, no, it doesn't cost that much, we can do it cheaper, okay? When the right says there's scientific uncertainty, the left says, no, everything is completely settled, which is not, in fact, the case, okay? They're buying into the framing of the right in answer, responding to these claims and taking the ethical arguments off the table, in my view, is like taking the hockey goalie out of the net, okay? The ethical arguments are much stronger ethical arguments, and I believe that there are people that will respond to the ethical arguments. In fact, there's a whole sociological, we need a social movement on this problem. And many social scientists says it's precisely ethical arguments made by someone in the Klan to say to their Klan what we're doing is ethically and morally unsupportable, which is responsible for social movements, okay? So if you want, we need a social movement, but there's some social science evidence that it is in fact moral arguments that get people to respond to see that, to tell our Klan that what we're doing is ethically and morally unacceptable. There's a new treaty that was agreed to in Durban in South Africa, so the status report on the ethical issues, I will end as follows. 2 years ago, the entire community not only agreed to degree warming, but to negotiate a complete new treaty. Every country in the world's agreed to have some commitment, some question whether it's a binding target or not. That's all negotiations. The next meeting of the parties is in Lima, Peru in December, which is a preparation for a 2015 Paris meeting, which everybody's agreed to a brand new treaty, okay? The mainstream scientific institution, the United Nations, the Intergovernment Panel on Climate Change, is saying countries are starting to make voluntary commitments, and I just mentioned what the US commitment is. So every country is starting to make voluntary commitments. But the story is they're not nearly strong enough to limit the warming, given a 260 gigaton budget to limit the warming. And the developing countries are saying, this is a death sentence for us. This is not a mere inconvenience. you know, the failure of this to do this is really harmful. So everybody's saying, how do we get the commitments to the level that would require to limit the warming to 2 degrees centigrade? By the way, you may have noticed a lot of people think 1.5 degrees centigrade is really not necessary. And most people believe that the only way we're going to get countries to do it is to come into the negotiations as if justice and obligations is the basis for the target. Every country actually agreed in the 1992 treaty to prevent dangerous anthropogenic interference with the climate system based upon equity. Okay, equity is understood to be a distributive justice. Okay, we already agreed that our commitment should be based upon justice and equity, but we're not talking about it. We don't talk about it that way, and we need people of conscience to force the United States to talk about it. I have some ideas about how we do this. I've actually was asked by the UN Secretary General's office that I could help them think through this. And so I've been thinking a lot about how do we turn up the volume. So I am delighted to be here. The Ethical and Cultural Society, I think you see the connection I get between what I'm talking about and this institution. And so I'm going to ask you, how do we get this done? How do we, yes.
Thank you very much for a stirring and passionate talk. I hope I'm not getting too religious by saying we know the master's dead and we're in despair, but we're looking for the resurrection here, especially on Easter morning. And so the question is, one comment along those lines. I heard Cal DeWitt talk recently from University of Wisconsin, and he pretty much took the opposite tack. He mostly showed us slides of the beauty of the Hudson Valley, which he had just been photographing. And so I wonder if there's somewhere in the middle where we can visit the land of despair in our purgatory, but also be bolstered by the hope and beauty that exists.
That's a very good question. As you can imagine, when I talk, people will say that. You undoubtedly maybe saw the New York Times op-ed piece a couple weeks ago. We talked about scare tactics and recommended talking about the positive. Okay, if I had time, I would have talked about the positive. But we also got to know how bad it is, too. Someone's got to talk about how bad it is, I think, which is not to say we don't always also show there is some positive information that the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change said we could do, it was still time to do this. And by the way, it only costs 0.06% of global GDP per year because solar energy is going way down much faster than we thought, okay? So there is a more hopeful sign to this, but geez, someone's got to talk about how bad it is, okay? And they're not talking about how bad it is. No one's talking about the U.S. because if you don't talk about how bad it is, the right's going to say, this is not a big deal, okay, you don't have to do anything. We don't have to raise a carbon tax. There's no need to it. I don't believe you can simply get there by only talking about the positive.
No, agree, but what's the bridge? You're asking us for the bridge. Tell us what you see as the bridge, then. Where we are to where we need
to. Solar energy is going down. Other countries in the world taking it seriously. Germany has a target of 40% renewables by 2030. They're tearing down their nuclear power plants to get there. Many countries in the world have much higher percentage of renewables than we do.
I have a concrete question. What can I do as an individual next month?
Okay. Well, you could. We all have an individual responsibility to lower our carbon footprint. To get every institution that we're engaged with, universities, churches, to lower their, we could have talked about what is my individual responsibility, and that's pretty scary in itself because we emit about 20 gigatons, or 20 tons as American. We got to be below 2 to have any claim that we have a fair share. In Europe, in Northern Europe and Scotland, all the churches are getting every member to do a carbon footprint, okay? So I would say, yeah, there's a lot of very practical on the ground stuff that we could do, including demanding that every subnational government, every organization, and each individuals take responsibility for this problem. I fly a lot. So if I don't offset my emissions, my carbon footprint's pretty high. I gave a lecture in Prague last year. It was at Audison. And I said, I think there's some people in this room that are not doing their moral share, and I'm going to tell you who they are. I'm going to name names. I had pictures of everybody in the audience, including myself. So we need to figure out how to get our carbon footprint down. It's a moral requirement. Yes? Yeah?
I seem to recall, years and years ago, that the one of the popes, I guess a couple popes back, came out against nuclear warfare and actually had an influence on the Catholic population, and there were people resigning from the Defense Department and things. So this new Pope seems to be a pretty cool dude, and I think maybe we could work in that direction.
Yeah, I've hoped the new Pope to be. Catholic bishops actually about 8 years ago issued a wonderful statement on the moral implications of climate change. So the Catholic bishops are way ahead of the Catholic Church on this. And there are religious institutions that have taken this all quite seriously. That's another sun quote. Yes.
One of your early slides showed the global temperatures over the last 100 million years.
100,000.
Right. But I noticed that about 12,000 years ago, there was a... the whole chart is very highly volatile.
Right.
But about 12,000 years ago, there was a sudden, very sharp rise.
That's right.
And it's been fairly steady since then.
Right. You know what happened?
12,000 was the end of the last ice age.
Right, yeah, but the reason why there was a sudden drop, because as we came out of the last ice age, the Gulf Stream shut down, okay? And so the sudden drop about 12,000 years ago, the reason why it rises so quickly, and a risk that we're running now, but we think the probability is pretty low, that we're gonna shut, most of the temperature distribution is through the oceans, okay? So Northern Europe is only warm as it is because the Gulf Stream takes the tropic water and distributes. But that is shut down through one of those switches. Okay, and the switch is fresh water that it melts when you come out of an ice age. You dilute the salt water, which makes the water more dense and makes the place where the Gulf Stream descends into the Atlantic a different place, which changes the temperature regime in Europe. So that's actually one of the switches we're worried about. It happened in the past. Just about 5 years ago, we thought we were going to do it again. And ironically, Europe would get much colder if that happened as the rest of the Earth warmed up. But we now think the warming is going to overwhelm that. Even if it happens, the warming is going to overwhelm the cold. But that's what happened at that point. Yes.
You were always talking
generally.
Yeah, microphone. We have a microphone.
Yes. Just to the point about what we can do individually, 350 New York City has a Switch to Wind campaign, a brochure is here for you to consider. We can all personally divest from fossil fuels as a supplier for electricity. So please look at the brochure, take it home with you. We can also call on all of our organizations, faith-based organizations, university, to divest fossil fuels from their endowments and or pension funds. That's also a campaign. 350 New York City and also Sierra Club, to which I belong, are involved. But I had a question for you about the climate change talks that will begin in September at the UN. Mm-hmm. A coalition is forming to demand climate justice.
Right.
And one question is, what do we ask in terms of goals for the US? And one threshold could be, and I'm asking your opinion about this, instead of the 17 to 18%,
right,
which Obama will present, what about 60% by 2030? That would be within the 15-year window of opportunity that the IPCC report is saying we have before we need to rely on as yet unknown technologies to remove carbon dioxide. So what about 60% by 2030 based on January 2014 as a baseline?
I like that number. I actually like it a lot for the reasons you suggest, but I suggest you ask for something else too. You want Obama to explain its position on the justice issues. How is that number related to what the US fair share is? How did they figure out what the fair share is? What ethical formula was used by the Obama administration? There's actually four or five ethical formula that are discussed in the literature that are plausible, supportable ways of resolving this problem of distributive justice. We want to force the government to explain its position on the atmospheric concentration. We want to get Obama to explain its position on the allocation formula, okay? And We want to do that with every country in the world. This one is the project I'm working on. Okay, how do you get every country in the world to explain the implicit positions of justice? And by the way, there's a lot of looking for hope. I teach human rights law right now. There's a real lot of interesting lessons about how we make this work. By the way, the human rights regimes work is any citizen can. This is also a human rights violation too, which has all sorts of interesting legal significance from that. But the NGOs can complain about nations failing to put pressure on them through the human rights regime, which I think are really relevant. We want to build the same kind of structure on this problem.
You're speaking generalizations and long-term goals, but you also tell us that something has to be done immediately.
Right.
And I would like to find out where are those areas where there is wind that is sustained long enough to make it economically feasible to supplement fossil fuel, as well as those areas where there is enough sun to make it economical. And if it is economical, it won't be difficult to convince people to make the investment.
Yeah, well, as you might imagine, there are already maps which are available on the web. Where is the wind in the United States that is currently economically feasible? So you actually can get those maps based upon current assumptions about economics. So, and there are some infrastructure issues to make it work. You need a smart grid to bring the power from west to east. There's still some policy. Economics alone, I don't think we'll do it. It will take us part of the way, but we still need to transform the electric generation system so we can make better use of the rules. So, but that information is widely available. I teach it in my classes. So a lot of wind in Pennsylvania, all of the ridges of the Appalachia, out at sea, as you know, there's a lot of underdeveloped wind potential. Okay, he's got the microphone. I'm sorry. Yes, go ahead.
It seems like in the worst case, this is a civilization-ending kind of thing.
Right.
If that's the case, are any means at all unjustified?
Right. But it's funny that you asked that question, because if you get a PhD in environmental policy at Harvard, you're only taught, when you get to these questions, you're taught to do neoclassical economic analysis. It's the only prescriptive tool. You're not taught about ethics. You're taught about, talk about cost-benefit analysis. Okay. I was in a room with John Broome, who is a philosopher in Great Britain of some respect, and he asked the students to put a price on if we kill everybody, how much is it worth? And my head wanted to explode for asking that question, because that's how policymakers are taught to think about this, to maximize human welfare. But that's not precisely your question. Is there anything ethically unjustifiable? It's actually, I never thought of that before. There probably is some things. I mean, starving your children, which is probably not ethically justifiable. I think what you're asking, there's no ethical justification for what we're doing. A monkey would get what's wrong with it. Once you frame it as an ethical issue, people get it, okay? That's another part of my experience. People say people don't get ethics, that's not my experience, okay? When you go out and force them to think about it, they get it, okay? I can tell you amazing experiences I had with that. One is I was asked by Penn State to brief the senior management of Aramco, the Saudi Arabian oil company, on the ethics of climate change. And they were so hostile, it's hard to describe how hostile it, but their mood completely changed by the end of my talk. They got it and they invited me back the next year. Okay, and so I actually think there is hope. There is some, I believe, and this is a claim, that there's some basic justice that we all get. Little children get it. Okay, the babies get it. About a year ago, it was the cover story of the New York Times Sunday magazine. This is offending basic justice, okay? It's not an esoteric justice problem. It's offending basic justice that most humans get. And that's why there's some cash value in talking about the ethical issues.
I've been advised that this will be the last question.
Okay, he's had his hand up for a while. Can
we've got to do time. Okay. She got to hand up for a while.
Okay, I'm Pamela. I see unfettered global capitalism as the monster in the coal pile for a lot of this. Now, with regard to the United States, appeals to logic are not going to work in this ultra-religious country. I think one of the ways of accomplishing awareness is to put it in the churches, put it in the religious institutions, make it a church or religious issue. That's the only thing that seems to move Americans, aside from the oligarchy that rules us.
You can't look at the global problems and you don't see a problem with the current form of capitalism that wants to pretend you can solve all problems by maximizing economic value. That's part of the problem here. It's not only a problem here, it's a problem of other problems that we're facing. It's a democracy problem, okay? This is a democracy problem. How do you prevent people with all the money from distorting the democracy, okay? That's the issue here. And this is an amazing example of the distortions, the capability, the tactics they use, the public relations firms, the advertising, the testing of words that they've used to frame this issue in the United States. So it is, in fact, the root of the problem. I agree completely.
There have been times in the past when volcanoes have blown up and cooled the earth
right. For
several years.
Right.
We have the technological capability to replicate that sort of thing. And set up rockets with Roger Sutherland and whatnot, which would in fact cool the Earth and would help that particular problem. I'm sure there are lots of risks associated with that because we really don't know where it's all going to go. But has anybody really dealt with that question? Because I think that's probably the best chance we've got to do something about this.
You probably know that's usually talked about under the word geoengineering, okay? Geoengineering is a solution to this problem, and IPCC has a whole chapter, including an ethical chapter on the ethics of geoengineering section in the IPCC report. There are both risk issues, but there are global institutional government issues with geoengineering. Who gets to decide? Because every geoengineering project is probably going to make someone worse off. If you change the temperature regime by doing that, although you may solve a long-term problem, there are winners and losers in most of the geoengineering problems. It may be a solution, but we need global governance, a democratically elected global governance to do that, I think. And they're all interesting ethical questions. Who sets the thermostat for the Earth? What empowers them to say that the average temperature of the Earth will be 60 degrees Fahrenheit, okay? And so there, it in itself is something to look at, seriously, I agree with you, but it also raises a host of other ethical questions. It raises ethical questions in addition to scientific questions.
Thank you.